opportunity to worship God by looking into His Word together. We invite your attention to the book of Acts. Book of Acts. If you turn to that, I will read a scripture from the book of Hebrews. Before we get started, though, I would like to thank you for your invitation to come and preach at Randolph. I've attended here in the past for various events and singings. Looking forward to worshiping with you on a regular basis. Appreciate the way the men have led us and the way everyone has participated. It is a wonderful privilege to be able to worship God in freedom and to have this opportunity together with brethren. My wife is here, Terry Mercer. She's a great encouragement, support. My mother, Linda, is here. And we have several brethren from the Huntsville Park Church of Christ. And we're hoping to have more coming our way. So we look forward to getting together and bonding together with brethren. Worshiping our Lord and serving Him. People are giving up on organized religion. Perhaps it's the discouragement of all the conflicting doctrines. When people are trying to reason and they hear that this person has the truth and this person has the truth, and yet there's an obvious contradiction, they may reason that maybe no one has the truth. A man by the name of Alan Bloom wrote a book a number of years ago that said that the average student in college today is taught and even believes that there is no such thing as absolute truth, that everything is relative. But Jesus taught something differently. And a long time ago, he said in John chapter 14, he said, "I am the way, the truth." In John 17:17, he said, "Sanctify them in by thy word, thy word is truth. Sanctify them by the truth." God's word is truth. Jesus said, "You shall know the truth. The truth shall set you free." John 8:32. So truth is something that exists and it can be known. In fact, it needs to be known. In fact, the entirety or sum of God's word is truth. Psalm 119, verse 160. And so since it can be known, it must be known for us to be free. It's good to know that God's word is truth, and we have in the scripture God's word written down for us. People are giving up, though, on organized religion. They're deciding for themselves that there's a better use of their time, and so they make decisions to go camping or to go to a sporting event or sleep in or go mountain climbing, do any number of things except try to get with an organized group of people that are gathered together for some kind of organized worship. You say, well, how big is this movement? Well, church buildings that once were filled with people are shuttering their doors. It's happening all over the United States. While missionaries are struggling to build buildings where people can assemble in other lands, we are shuttering our doors. You say, how large is this movement? According to George Barna in his book, Revolution, he said that in a survey of people that there are 20 million people that once were affiliated with organized religion and they've given up on it. 20 million strong. You say, well, how large is that? It is very large. It's one of the largest group of so-called religious peoples in America, and yet they have no identification with anyone. They're kind of a lone ranger Christian, if you just to coin a very broad term, trying to strike out on their own, separate from the body of Christ, and trying to do religion individually and without a group of people. But we understand from the book of Ephesians that the church of Christ is what it is because of the cross of Christ. Ephesians 2, verse 10. And we learn that the church of Christ is the body of Christ, and we are members individually of that body. And so if you could separate an arm from a body, how effective would that arm be? If you could separate a leg from a body, how effective would the leg be? You see, people trying to live apart from Christ and His church are really doing something that goes against Scripture. It's an idea that no doubt has its And so people have basis for their reasoning. But there's an old saying that says, don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. Well, that's what they're doing. They're just jettisoning the whole thing by saying, okay, if I can't have it exactly right, I'll just do away with it. And so people are voting with their feet, where once there were full pews, there are now empty pews. Where there were once a lot of people, the majority of American society, attending services on the Lord's Day to worship God, now the majority do not. What does the Bible say to Christians, members of the church? Well, we're very familiar with Scripture in Hebrews 10, verse 25, but 24 goes with it, where it says, let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works. When we consider one another, we're going to be thinking about someone beyond ourselves. A person says, well, I don't get anything out of organized religion, meeting with people. I like to go out in my boat and look at nature and think about God that way. Or I like to go golfing on Sunday morning with my friends and we talk about spiritual things on the golf course. Well, that's an idea wholly foreign to Scripture. We know that there is a purpose for God's people coming together. He says, let us consider one another. It's not about what I like on Sunday morning, but what does God want me to do? What is best for others? Well, when we consider one another, it's reciprocal. I think about you, you think about me. And in this consideration, we stir up one another to love and good works. I hope that when you leave the assembly, you want to love God more. And you want to love your fellow man more. And that you are stirred up or provoked to do good things, to maintain good works. And he says, how do we do this? Verse 25, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. So here's the assembling of the saints. Christians coming together. And he says, there were some in his day forsaking the assembly. And of course, we see this happening in our day. He says, don't do this. Consider one another, how that you can stir one another up to love and good works. And so that is a good reason for us to make a regular habit of coming together to stir one another up with encouragement and exhortation. Now to the book of Acts. In the book of Acts, chapter 2, we have the first gospel sermon. This is when the Lord established his church. People cried out in their sin, what shall we do? Peter said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins. And so they that gladly received his word, verse 41, were baptized. And we find out in Acts chapter 2 that the Lord added the saved to the church. And that's how he started and constituted the church. And he continued to do this. Verse 47 says that they were praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. But the church was not an invisible body of individuals meeting out in society by themselves. No, they were a corporate group that could be seen assembling together. And then they left the assembly to go serve and to teach and to be an example. And to influence like salt and light in a very dark and tasteless world. When we continue to chapter 4, we find what this early church was doing. It says, verse 32 of Acts 4, the multitude of those who believed were one heart and one soul. There's the unity of God's people. Neither did anyone say that any of the things he possessed was his own, but they had all things in common. And with great power, the apostles gave witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. Nor was there anyone among them who lacked, for all who were possessors of lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of the things that were sold, and laid them at the apostles' feet, and they distributed to each one as had need. And Joseph, who was also named Barnabas by the apostles, which is translated son of encouragement, the Levite of the country of Cyprus, having land, sold it and brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. So there were needs, and the early church helped one another. And there was one man who stood out. His name was Joseph. And he was also named Barnabas. That was his nickname. Barnabas means son of encouragement or son of consolation. Barnabas was the encourager. Now imagine that there is in this church one that may stand above the others as a great encourager. Sometimes in a church I can pick out the Job, the one who is suffering, it seems, more than the others. And they have a special conflict that they have to deal with. And sometimes you have more than one Job. But then you will have in churches several people like Barnabas who are trying to encourage, and maybe one that stands out above the others. Well, this man stood out above the others because he was such an encourager. They just named him the encourager, or Barnabas. I want to be like Barnabas. It would be good if we could all be like Barnabas so that we could stir one another up to love and to good works. I hope when we leave here, we can say it was good for us to be here. David said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. I hope that when we look to services, it's not a burden we bear, but a privilege we enjoy, an encouragement. I know that we've been encouraged with the singing this morning because it's a delight to sing with God's people very capably led this morning. Appreciate that very much. Well, let's continue in the book of Acts and notice chapter 11, how that the church was growing. It made it all the way 300 miles north from Jerusalem where the church started. And the Gentiles were pressing into the church. And the Gentiles were becoming Christians. And it says in verse 19, those who were scattered after the persecution that arose after Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia, Cyprus, remember that's where Barnabas came from, and Antioch, preaching the word to no one but the Jews only. So they preached, first of all, the Jews. But then it says, verse 20, some of them were men from Cyprus and Cyrene, who, when they had come to Antioch, spoke to the Hellenists, preaching the Lord Jesus. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number believed and turned to the Lord. The news of these things came to the ears of the church in Jerusalem, and they sent out the complainer to go discourage everybody. Now, that's not what it says. It says they sent out Barnabas to go as far as Antioch. They picked out the encourager. They said, you travel from Jerusalem, you go 300 miles north to this church we're hearing about in Antioch, and encourage them. And so when he came, verse 23, this is one of my favorite verses. When Barnabas came and had seen the grace of God, he was glad and encouraged them all that with purpose of heart, they should continue with the Lord. What did Barnabas see when he came to Antioch? He saw the grace of God. What is the grace of God? That's God's favor. That's God's goodness. God had opened the doors of the church not only to Jews, but to Greeks, to Gentiles, and people were becoming one in Christ Jesus. And he saw this grace. It was great. It made his heart glad to see people who were once fighting one another now getting along as brothers. People talk about trouble in the Middle East. There's been trouble in the Middle East.